Every journey is like turning a page of the Book of the World, and every page has its beauty, its wisdom and its sorrow. But some pages carry a light that fills their wisdom and turns their sorrow into truth. Why does Christianity have a bad name today?
Hypocrisy and bigotry of Christians. The hypocrisy and bigotry that we have is, first of all, to think that we have a special righteousness or holiness as Christians automatically simply because we're Christians, without any kind of real sincere work to transform our hearts and to transform our inner person, to transform our being so that we come into an accord with the moral imperatives of Jesus Christ, rather than with the moral laws which people have superimposed on Christ.
În Canada, de unde sunteți?
Din Vancouver.
Ați venit din multă România?
Da, multă ori. Acum 5 ani am venit fiecare an.
Da. Veți căsătoriți?
Nu.
Vă faceți mănaș?
Nu știu. Nu știu încă.
Crezi de față, mâna. Sunteți catolici?
Nu, ortodox.
Ortodox.
When I come to Romania, I feel welcomed like I'm coming home. Its beauty and simplicity are enchanting. Coming here often feels like a journey back in time. But as one of the newest members of the European Union, Romania is a land of changes. Shopping malls are replacing markets, and traffic jams are replacing the horse and cart. But Orthodox Christianity keeps its traditions alive here, much as it has since Romania was converted to Christianity by the Apostle Andrew in the first century. I've come to explore this ancient Christian world, to look into the roots of the Christian faith. I want to know what a Christian life means, if there still are saints and mystics in this modern time, and what light I might capture in my own soul, if I meet one. My journey starts in Bucharest. It was once called the Paris of the East for its buildings, boulevards, and culture, but it was heavily scarred by the communist era. I've come here to talk to people who can shed light on the spirituality of the Orthodox Church.
Perfect, mulțumesc.
Cu plăcere.
The Orthodox Church is the place where people are coming in order to meet our Lord and to change their life, and after that to arise and to live with in a spiritual life, to live with our God and with the saints, to live in His kingdom, the heavenly kingdom.
I wonder how religion can actually help us to change ourselves. Because I know that many people go to church every Sunday and say their prayers every day, but only very, very few really get to know God and become saints.
The word religion comes from the Latin religare, which means to relink, the soul of the individual to God. When we look into the world of religion, we have to make difference between the social institution and the path of the individual, which is searching for its inner essence, for its inner light. We can see the spiritual aspect of the religion through the transformation of the individual. We can see that he is better, we can see that he is more enlightened, he understands from a different perspective life. Then we are certain that its inner pursuit had some effects.
You see, there's only one nature of all mankind. We all share in the same human nature. So everything that one of us does affects the whole. Like dropping a pebble into the water till the ripples move out to the edge of it. When St. Anthony the Great went into the desert, he was struggling for all of mankind, not just for himself, because he understood that if he struggled and there was less darkness in him, there would be less darkness in the whole of the human nature. And to the degree that he acquired the light, there would be more light in the human nature itself.
I'm starting to see how Christianity is actually a spiritual path. When I was 14, I started to ask myself questions about who I am, why I'm here. But at that time, Christianity was just a neon cross in the sky next to the mall that I passed on my way to school. But here I can feel that Christianity really gives people their perspective on their place in the universe.
To me, it's interesting to see Orthodox culture, which is one of the reasons why I came here in the first place. You know, on the streets, people will cross themselves when they walk in front of a church. There's always a possibility, you know, sometimes you hear rumors of you know, some holy monk tucked away in the hills somewhere. You know, there's always the possibility you might meet someone like this, or might be able to go meet someone like that. And to me, it's also been very interesting to see, you know, what mark communism and communist oppression has left in a culture, in a society, in people.
The communist period in Romania was from 1947 to 1989, and it was a time of heavy religious and spiritual suppression. But it seems that the people's faith stood up better to communism than it is to capitalism now.
In the 60s and 70s of America, when they were referring to the communists as the godless commies, or the godless communists, because of this religious suppression.
Yeah.
But what I think is interesting these days is how actually, and it's the reason for my journey here, there's somehow a huge wave of atheism in the West now. So why do you think that is, that we have this basically modern atheism?
One thing that I think I've noticed here, being in Romania, on a real practical level, is that capitalism and communism are both the two materialistic cultures. How capitalism came to be atheist, I mean, you know, you just kind of put God aside and do business, get money, and and then kind of go to church on Sundays. And after a few generations of that behavior, you're going to end up not believing in God anyways. But I think another huge issue, especially in Western culture, is a fundamental misconception of who God is and what he does. And we can see that by how the West interprets Christ's crucifixion, which is kind of, you know, God had to punish somebody. He didn't want to punish us, so he wanted to punish his son. But God came to heal the world, not to judge the world. He came to heal humanity, not to judge humanity.
In Christianity, it seems that Jesus wanted to teach us as much with his death as with his life. And I think it is a critical point for understanding the path that he gave us.
If Christ was punished on our behalf, then we're never forgiven, because punishment and forgiveness are mutually exclusive. So this idea that God is so filled with vengeance and that he himself is in bondage to some immutable law of the universe, whereby he has to demand a juridical justice for every offense against him. This is the concept of God, which is really the foundation of modern atheism. When our Lord Jesus Christ was crucified, he could have been executed how many ways? But to take the lowest, meanest form of death, he showed solidarity with the lowest and the meanest of humanity. He could identify with the suffering of mankind. And he took that suffering upon himself in order to heal us. This is the Christian life. To struggle to come to that kind of love, which is an imitation of the love which Christ himself manifested on the cross, the co-suffering love for mankind, for all of humanity.
If Jesus hadn't been crucified, then we haven't had resurrection, which is very important in our lives. Jesus' resurrection is a symbol for our possible resurrection, which means regaining the primordial state, which means reuniting with God.
These days in Bucharest have been something of a revelation for me. I start to enter a way of thinking which sees God's kindness in this world, and hears, if only from time to time, the soft whisper of my soul which yearns to go home. But it's hard to hear this whisper above the noise of the city and the noise of my own mind, which is filled by so many scattered thoughts.
In our consumer capitalist age, where the whole economic system and social system lives like a parasite on the passions of mankind, there is some place where all this is renounced. There is some place where that is conquered and set at nothing. Consequently, there is hope, and it's to give that hope to the rest of the Christian community that monasticism functions most of all in our day.
Okay. Bine, o bilet atunci. Cât costă?
130.
Mulțumesc.
I'm happy to be moving again. I'm going north to Putna Monastery near the Ukrainian border. Spending the whole day on the train is a good way to see the country. While full of beauty, the landscape also tells stories of the struggles of the people. I'm looking forward to experiencing monastic life. I've always held a certain awe for the men and women who give up their worldly lives, all their ambitions and goals, the families they had and the ones they'll never have, for the search for the truth, for the wish to do God's will. Budna is one of the most revered monasteries of Romania, and it's one of the only monasteries that has never closed since it was founded in 1466. During the communist time, many monasteries were shut down and monks and nuns were sent to labor camps. But Budna stayed open, apparently thanks to a small group of strong monks who refused to stop their life of prayer. Now there are about 80 monks in Budna, and they follow a life which hasn't changed much since monasticism began in the 4th century.
Doamne Dumnezeul nostru, Cel ce pedepsești și iarăși tămăduiești, care ridici de la pământ pe cel sărac și din gunoi nas pe cel lipsit tatălor, fanilor, limanul celor înfărași și doctorul celor bolnavi, Cel ce porți fără mâhnire slăbiciunile noastre și asupra suferințele noastre, care miluiești cu liniștirea Cel ce treci peste fără de lege și ierzi nedreptățile, Cel gram spre ajutor și de bani la mânie, care e sufla și Sfânta Liturghie.
Slavă ție, Doamne, slavă ție,
Domnule, să ne rugăm.
Doamne, părinții și frații acestei sfinte mănăstiri, toți cei care ne-au poruncit nouă nevrednicilor să ne rugăm pentru dânsi și toți cei care sunt bolnavi și le iartă lor greșelile, cele de voie, cele fără de voie, cele de
And what does it involve practically to live in the monastery?
Maybe the main difference, exterior difference, is letting many exterior troubles outside from the doors of the monastery. For example, a monk try to don't focus on how to build a big company or how to win some prizes or how to do something, but how to find God, to know God, to how to reach God. It's the area of preoccupation is very, very strictly.
And as a monk, what are the vows that you take?
We have to live in chastity, and this is body chastity, but mind chastity, because we can do sins just with mind, not necessarily with body. The second is poverty. A monk hasn't personal money or personal things, because a monk is a gift to God. A monk is a man who is putting himself, all his life, in the hand of God. And the third one is the obedience. This is man, all of his will, put in the hand of God, and he try all the time to do God's will to him.
In the monastery, obedience means to do a work for the community to run. The monks vow to obey, so they give up their will. Let God's will come through them.
It should be a fixed criterion for searching God's will. No, it's not like a fuzzy criterion, let's say. Should be a fixed criterion. And this fixed criterion is exactly this, the spiritual father of monk, the abbot in a monastery.
Ascultarea nu înseamnă doar numai a practica o muncă aici în mănăstire, ci ascultarea este taina lui Hristos. Hristos Domnul, când ne gândim la taina lui, când am spus taina lui Hristos, trebuie obligatoriu să ne gândim la smerenia lui Hristos, la ascultarea lui Hristos față de Tatăl și la jertfa lui Hristos. Când Mântuitorul Hristos spune, Dumnezei sunteți, suntem Dumnezei după har. Prin jertfa noastră, prin ascultarea noastră, ne îndumnezeim pe noi și devenim fii ai lui Dumnezeu după har.
The work is for God, not for the monks, not for the work itself. You know, we don't do art for the purpose of art. We don't do prayer for the purpose of prayer.
As I worked with them, I felt like I became part of a greater process, that I was a cell integrated in a greater being. I watched as the work unfolded before us, exactly as we can watch the seasons unfold, preparing the landscape for the next one. I'm always impressed by the paintings and icons they use to show the spiritual history of the Church and to represent the invisible world. The Orthodox don't see them as just pictures of people, but as windows into heaven.
That come to give something to understand the gospel. It's not the same when some talk about, but where you see also, it's something, the communication between the man and the sky and the God. It's something so deep. The sense have this role to make intermediary between me, him, and God. This is the way. Because sometimes I don't have the power to talk directly to the God. Oh, it's so hard. But I say, my Saint Nicola, I know you make many, many miracles. Make with me something, you know? This is the way.
Which is your favorite icon?
Oh my God, it's so difficult question, because what I like, I make, I like it, you know. Of course, where I am in front of Virgin Mary, on Jesus Christ, I have, you know, something so special, because I know His power, it's God, and I paint with so attention, but for every saint I make something from me. What you see now, when I paint now, this is the Saint Peter, where he come in the home of Tavita. She died and he make the resurrection from Tavita.
In the church and throughout the monastery, the pictures help to remind me that God is here. What's the most difficult part of the monastic life to fulfill?
Fighting with yourselves. This is the fighting monastic life. And this can be done with the help of God. Monastic life somehow is a fight with God. because God give us free will. And in monastic life, we cut our free will. We make obedience.
And you want
but
to give it back.
God, yes, but God love to cut our will and to give to Him. You know, exactly like I give a gift to you and you give some gift improved to me, and our relation is growing up through this, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Because you don't use this will, this gift, selfish for yourself, but you give to me, to use to together. Of course, I will give to you more beautiful, and that's you give to me more beautiful. And that is growing up. The faith, the love, the hope, the knowledge of God, the understanding of God's will, and the practice of God's will. To this, we have in Romanian a sentence that said, a gift from a gift make heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Dar din dar se face rai. It's very, very, very beautiful when you make gifts.
One way that the monks give is to pray for the others in the community around them. The faithful who come write the names of their friends and families, both living and dead. And the monks take these prayer lists as part of their daily practice. In Orthodox monasteries, the monks are called fathers, and each of them must spend at least a year as a brother before taking lifelong vows to consider whether or not they want to commit to this life.
I was sure to become a priest from the age of 14. I want to tell you a little story. When I was in the elementary, I prayed very much God to know what shall I do in my life. I want to be very sure God, because it's very important to me. And I was at the Sihastria monastery. Everybody was kneeling, and I said to God in my heart like something like this. I saw a girl, a little girl from 5 or 6 years. If this little girl will turn with her face to me, not to the altar, and she will kneel in front of me, I will be sure, very sure, that I will be a priest. And I am repeating, everybody was kneeling with the face to the altar, but that little girl stand up, and she turned her face to me, and with her back to the altar. And I thought something like this: oh God, I know, just I know I will be a priest. I have finished my university studies. I saw a very difficult problem. To be a priest in these days, a priest with a family, a priest with some obligations, means to make some difficult choices. I was sure about these times that I have to be a monk, not a priest. It was very difficult to renounce. I wanted to be a person like the other ones, and to renounce at your pleasures, it's very difficult. And it was a fight in my heart. But from the moment I have been in the monastery, I renounced, because I know that God is here, just here. Not in the space, not in heavens, not in, no, I don't know where, but here. And in every moment of my life, I have to confess, in many occasions I forget this, and I'm making what the Orthodox names sins. That is the sin, to forget that God is with you and want you.
It's 4:30 in the morning and the monks begin the first service in the church.
Din elevăște omul celor din peste căciunea căzut și cu izgorirea cea cumplită din viață sândindu-se Sfintelor Mucenițe rugați Dumnezeu pentru noi, cu darul cel ce cel întrei lumini luminându-se fecioarele au risipit întunericul.
Prayer echoes here day and night, and soon enters your dreams also. How much do the monks pray?
It's very difficult. Monks, every monk is a monk. But the general and the rule and the necessary is to pray all the time, in your heart. But you have to go to service, or you like, or you want, or you go to service. It's not something that is imposing from outside. It's something that you go, you eat because you need to eat. You go to serve because you want to eat spiritually, let's say, in this world. Full program of service in a monastery is about 8 hours a day, but we have to do in the same time obedience. So we have to mix them, let's say. In the time of obedience, again, we try to pray. It's not easy, but the big fathers, the big saints of the church, reach this point to pray all the time. When they sleep, when they walk, when they speak with other person, when they work in the garden. But on this top of the prayer are very few. But this is the point every monk want to arrive, but not, I told you again, prayer for prayer, but prayer for reaching God, prayer to repent our sins.
With the constant focus on God here, I can feel my perspective changing. I start to feel why the monks would choose the life they have. I start to get glimpses of the world of prayer. What is it to know God, if God knows everything, is everywhere, and unlimited? I have a glimpse of what it would mean to believe in Him, to have faith, because if He is, then everything is perfect. There is nothing to fear and nothing to desire. There is only an overwhelming joy of the gift of this heart and soul. God knows my needs before they rise within me, and God knows my prayers before they are formed. He is my prayers and their formation, and everything I am, and everything I am not.
Our prayer should become a prayer of complete silence in the heart, when we can be still and know that I'm God. The prayer of silence, the prayer of Hezekiah, inner silence and inner peace. Because words are the language of this world and silence is the language of the world to come. But the word and the silence are one.
For the beginners like me, I'm sure that God is with me. In 1 year and a half till this very moment, only you'll be surprised, but only 4 or 5 minutes I felt that God is with me. I feel that I want to die in that very moment and go with Him. The rest of the time I fought. I thought to come back to that was 5 or 4 minutes of loving God. Coming in a monastery is something like death. I don't exist anymore for the world. I have no mother. Even she lives in this moment. She lives, but like a brother in the monastery, I don't have a mother. I don't have a sister. I don't have any goods on this earth. Only this shirt. I do not exist. Only when I am praying, I start to exist.
The angels are singing, they are singing the glory of God continuously, and that's the celestial liturgy which holds also the world. And down on earth, by liturgy, people are doing the same, are just reflecting this divine liturgy. Holy Liturgy is at the core of the Orthodox spiritual life, and it is the communal celebration and worship of the divine world we came from. It's impossible to do a liturgy alone. There needs to be at least two people, the priest and one person to say, Amen, so be it. Because central to the liturgy is that we affirm together that God is, and that God comes to us. And they say that when we hold a liturgy, the whole spiritual community attends, all the saints and angels, with Jesus in the first place. It took some discipline to stay still and to stay standing during the many hours of prayer at the liturgy. I don't understand much of what they say, but I do understand, Lord, have mercy. And the Lord's Prayer, which came many times.
The human heart has a special ability to recognize what is sacred. And I felt like these prayers and the songs definitely came from the soul, both from those who composed them hundreds of years ago and those who maintain this tradition. Despite the stiffness in my legs, I felt lighter afterwards, purified. I felt permeated by the faith of all the people there.
The main point with the liturgy is that is meeting completely Lord Jesus Christ. He was, as a God and as a man, on the earth about some 2,000 years ago. And we don't see him in blood and flesh. We know him from books, we know him from the gospel in the first place, we know him from our parents, from the priest. But in the same liturgy, we can be together with Lord Jesus Christ, and through him with all the Holy Trinity. All the existence of the universe is concentrated in the Holy Liturgy. Mm-hmm. That's why we do just one Holy Liturgy on one day, in one altar. Because it's all the universe concentrated there. And in the liturgy, the top is when after the words of Transfiguration, where the bread and wine became the blood and flesh, holy blood and holy flesh of Jesus Christ, and when the priest and after the people take the Holy Communion, it's the profoundly union between man and Jesus Christ, between a man and God on this earth. Holy Communion.
Before going to my first confession, I read a long list of things that are considered sin in the Orthodox Church. 390 entries were on that list. Of course, there were many relating to the Ten Commandments and the seven deadly sins, as you would expect. But what struck me were the sins of the heart towards God, that simply not fulfilling the fullness of your life, not loving God to the extent that you can, not living your truth, is considered a sin. And for me, this felt like the most important of them all, that we must be real to ourselves completely, real to our souls, not just to our desires. It was a trial to confess, to go through all the things which I felt bad about. I felt I should not have done mistakes I had made. It was a humbling experience. And it was a good preparation for what was to follow the first time I took Holy Communion. It's a moment when eternity can enter into time, and we can make a bridge between here and the divine realm. When I took communion, I felt something entering me. And when I returned to my place in church, an intense prayer rose within me. I felt transparent to God, and I could only pray, "Glory to God, glory to God, praised be the Lord." It felt exactly as they described the angels praying the glory of heaven. Not with any earthly glory, not with any glory of this world, just the glory of all existence. I just had the feeling that existence is sacred. The monks of Putna have the right conditions to realize their goal. They have very few distractions and very many reminders, so contrary to the ordinary world. My time here has deepened my connection with myself, and I feel like I'm in God's care. Romania is still home to a few great church fathers who have reached extraordinary levels of prayer. Everywhere I went, people recommended me to go and find them and try to talk with them. At Putna, one of the monks told me about a hermit I could visit, Father Proclu. While I was trying to find him, I met Father Lucian. He'd also heard of him, but had never visited. So he offered to take me.
Father Proclu lives near a small village, you know? He doesn't live in the forest.
Yeah.
But
here still lives as a hermit. Christ, you know,
yeah.
In this area.
Yeah.
You know, the saints who are full for Christ.
Yeah, I've heard of some. It's a little bit crazy.
Yeah. They manage to seem like they're crazy. But inside it's another.
Inside it's quite clear.
It's quite clear and it's quite heavenly.
What is the right attitude we should have when we pray?
Cum ar trebui să ne rugăm?
Strigă la Dumnezeu prin fapte bune. Și dacă n-avem fapte bune, măcar rău să nu fac. Noi suntem unele dăți pe măsură și ne smerim și ne ducem viață de pocăință. Duhul Sfânt ne ajută să ne ridicăm.
How does it feel when the Holy Spirit works through us, through Him?
Cum cunoaștem că Sfântul Duh lucrează în noi?
Când lucrează Duhul Sfânt, atâta ne simțim de fericiți și suntem izbăviți de gânduri rele, de gândurile spurcate, suntem feriți și putem cugeta drept legea lui Dumnezeu. Iar când se departă Duhul Sfânt, atunci dau navală, gânduri spurcate, huli, și dacă vedem că dă navală prin huli, atunci trebuie să-i spun așa: tătă hula ta asupra capului tău să fie. Și atunci trebuie să zic așa: slavă ție, Dumnezeu nostru, slavă ție. Și asta, dar e o putere sfântă și atâta sfânt, acele bucurii nu le pot spune cuiva că nu se aseamănă cu acele. Nu se aseamănă cu acele. Asta nu se aseamănă. Și numai acela te poate înțelege care le-a avut cândva acele daruri. Așa. N-am litatul și aveau și sunt oameni. Maica Domn să vă ierte. Maicuța Domn să vă mântuiască. Amin. Doamne ajută. Cât pot sus. Așa. Doamne ajută!
Haideți evorie lor tehnică la atingea lasă! Haideți primul care trebuie evorie!
I've come to believe that the great mystery actually lives within me. It exists in each of us, and that there are some people who have revealed it to themselves. They cannot reveal it to anyone else because it is beyond external revelation. They can give hints, they can give guidance, they can light the way. And the first light is just to know that it is possible.
Father Arseni is one of the great fathers still alive in Romania. He's 96 years old and spent many years in communist prison for his faith. I was surprised at how easy it was to see him and how open he was.
Când ați fost intrat în mănăstire?
Când am venit la mănăstire?
Da.
În 47.
47.
60 de ani în urmă.
Da.
Da. Aici terminasem armat.
Așa.
'26
ceva, da. Așa. Ați fost 26. Și despre rugăciune personal, cum este o relație între, de exemplu, eu și Dumnezeu. Dar
dumneavoastră, o relație Dumnezeu este să aveți inima spre El, că nu are atât nevoie de cuvintele noastre, de inima noastră are nevoie Dumnezeu. Atunci suntem și în măsura în care iubim oamenii, ai măsura de iubirea Dumnezeu spre Dumnezeu. O ființă, dacă Mântuitorul s-a făcut om, nu s-a făcut să facă demonstrații. Să stabilească încă o dată, de după creație, care este mersul și care e ținta mersului nostru, în Părăția de Sus. Ființa umană este superioară ființei îngerilor. Deci umanitatea este superioară angelității îngerilor.
Cum suntem superiori din îngerilor, dacă îngerilor sunt mai aproape de Dumnezeu?
Păi nu e vorba de o apropiere fizică, e vorba de har. Pentru că nu poate fi Dumnezeu după har, dacă a venit Mântuitorul. A venit în chip de om, ne-a restaurat și am devenit una cu El. Și prețui cât prețuiește El.
Și din punct de vedere spiritual?
Da.
Ce este o chestie importantă? Ce este important?
Ce este ce?
Important.
Să fii mereu într-o relație cu Dumnezeu permanent. Asta vă dau și eu fapt. Orice faceți, gândiți-vă și la Dumnezeu, la Maica Domnului. Atunci, treaba care o face, un fel de rugăciune. Dar să ai mereu mintea la Dumnezeu.
Continuat.
Pentru că la moarte, dacă n-ai dus o viață după Hristos, ai să ai mari suferințe. Și nu mai e motiv să spui că n-ai știut. Uite că știi. Dumnezeu nu-i supărat pe noi pentru anumite păcate. Care facem atât de multe, sper că suntem nepăsători. Mergem pe inerție. Nu mergem pe adevăr. Am fost ieri așa, fac și altul așa. Dar nu e așa, orice timp e extrem de scump. Și nu ne lasă Dumnezeu timpul ăsta, că nu ne dă decât ca să ne formăm după mișește. Să ne pregătim pentru ziua cea din urmă. Că moartea e realitate. Și nu vrem să-i faci o cafea. Moarte. E o realitate.
Da, e adevărat.
I'm envious of how simple and clear the lives of these men are. It seems they've overcome all their doubts. They just have a clear direction and a clear goal. And now they can share their peace with others.
Și asta este unitate într-un stat.
The last father I'm going to see is Father Justin Pârvu. He's one of the most revered Christian fathers in Romania, and there's always a long line of visitors and spiritual children waiting to ask him for guidance. I was ready for a long wait, but an enthusiastic monk ushered me in ahead of the others, since he thought I was a novelty.
Pentru noi e important să vorbim despre legături direct cu Dumnezeu.
Hei, dar păi nu e ușor. Am trebuit timp.
Eu am timp.
Păi ai timp, răsă, dar n-am dar, eu.
Dacă mai bine să facem mâine, facem mâine.
Dar am să vă dau eu, un părinte care să se ocupe cu asta.
Inglis.
Domnul ăștia, părinte.
Doamne ăștia.
Binecuvântați,
părinte. Mai uite ce facem. Mă gândesc să merg la părintea Atanasie, care are timp să-i divorc cu el acolo.
Merg
la dâns. Așa.
Și mâine aveți timp
pentru mâine asta? Mâine să vedem. Mergi cu părinte, cu părintea Atanasie acolo, la el să merg, să stai de vorbă cu el. Așa.
Okay.
Să merge și cu dânsul cu Tălmaciu. Cu Tălmaciu acolo.
If he would like to say something about the prayer of the heart, the Jesus prayer.
Spune dacă ați putea să spuneți ceva despre rugăciunea inimii, rugăciunea lui Iisus.
Domnilor, vreți prea multe, dumneavoastră. În arhitectură e un principiu, domnilor. Eu am făcut și arhitectura, unde și unul a făcut mai multe lucruri, deși nu am certificare pentru asta. Mai puțin înseamnă mai mult. Eu dacă vă spun mai mult, dumneavoastră nu rețineți nimic. Aia ca să știți. Rugăciunea inimii, o viață lupți pentru ea. Și nu ești stăpân pe ea. Așa credeți dumneavoastră că e așa de ușor treaba asta. Fac și rugăciunea inimii, fac și cu tare. Nu faceți nimic dacă faceți așa. Faceți puțin și bun. Și până pune și altă cremide, tot solidă, și faceți ceva. Dacă faceți de toate, nu faceți nimic. Nu că nu pot să vă spun, eu practic rugăciunea inimii. Adică nu trebuie să spun. Am cunoscut oameni care au învățat-o pe sub paturi, bătuți. Nu m-a învățat nimeni.
Este de admirat la dumneavoastră că tineri vă puneți problema aceasta. Dom'le, lucrurile se măsoară cu rezultatele. Dumneavoastră trebuie să produceți un element, un fenomen care să dea insomnie. Ăla care știe cartea să spune, dom'le, mai scrii? Mai scoți o ediție? Atunci are valoare ce scoateți dumneavoastră. Dacă nu, trece pe la ureche, mănâncă înghețată sau știu ciocă, Coca-Cola, ce mai bea și trece mai departe. Dumneavoastră trebuie să produceți o schimbare în om. Asta e valoarea lucrului. Dacă produce o schimbare. Dacă e ceva cotidian, mâine apare altă ediție și dăm treaba asta. Dacă vrei să faci ceva valoros.
He's saying that your interview has to be very important and the message should be well received in the Canadian people.
Acolo e îndreptat.
I think both Father Pârvu and Father Athanasie were not interested in answering my questions because they were theoretical and just things I could read in a book. I have the feeling that what they are interested in is helping people find their way. And actually Father Athanasie did help me. And as for tomorrow, we'll see tomorrow.
Vrea să știe.
How can I find the staircase in my heart to reach God?
Cum să găsească o scară în inima lui prin care să ajungă la Dumnezeu?
Cum să ajung la Dumnezeu?
Da.
Pe fapta bună. Să crezi, să dăjduiești,
believe,
să iubești.
love, have faith.
And with what kind of prayer?
Cu ce fel de rugăciuni?
Rugăciunea este de mai multe feluri.
There are different kinds of faith.
Cu mintea.
And prayers. With your mind, with your heart.
Cu gura. Și gura.
And with your mouth.
Alo?
Stai, lasă. Alo, da. Așa. E, păi îmi scrie de la una, la drept, acolo. Așa,
băi. And I'd like to know, what is the right attitude for using the prayer of the heart, the Jesus prayer?
Care este atitudinea corectă pe care trebuie să o ai când rostești o rugăciune către Iisus Hristos?
Să fii spovedit, să ai liniște, așa, și o dragoste de rugăciune.
And what is the end of this path? What can we reach with this prayer?
Ce putem atinge prin rugăciune? Care e finalul?
Contopirea cu infinitul.
To be one with the infinite.
Dacă le faci pe asta,
mântuit.
Nu mântuit, desăvârșit.
Pilgrimage here has taken me across the land of my soul, as much as across the beautiful Romanian landscape. I feel full, uplifted, and at peace. I feel my heart so clearly, and a feeling of being integrated in creation. And now I've come to the cave of St. John Cassian. He was a great saint from the 5th century, who taught that we can reach God through purifying ourselves, living a life of discipline and generosity, and finally by developing a mystical awareness through identifying with the transfigured Christ. God's grace overflows in every moment of my life, but all too often I am blind to it, paying attention to what is passing instead of what is eternal.
I felt for the first time that Jesus actually is. Until now, it was just an idea, just a name, a story from a book, a picture on a wall, but not a reality, a living truth, a man that I could embrace, who would embrace me, and so much more than that. A hand from the heavens, reaching down to lift me up, to show me the meaning of life, the beauty of this world, which is all contained within us. I still don't know how I will reach God, if I will reach God in this life, if there is a great state, an altered perception, a higher reality that I can actually experience. But I do know that the Lord is merciful, full of love. And knowing that, remembering that, the goals in the future don't matter. What's important is now, another moment of loving God.
Oh, Oh, my God.